And again, we want to thank you for being on this call today with Monica Rabella, CPA and President of Rabella Accountancy, which is a CPA firm that specializes in accounting, tax, and consulting services for hundreds of dentists in California. Our topic of the call today is wage and hour, hot topics for today's dental practice. If you are not a current client of Rabella Accountancy or have not met her, Monica Rabella is a CPA and has 26 years of accounting and tax expertise, which includes 13 years working with the Big Four, Big Eight firms, and over 13 years experience working with dental practices. She is past president of the Orange County Long Beach chapter of the California Society of CPAs and is a member of the AICPA. She has conducted training sessions for accounting firms, as well as lectured on tax and business matters to the California Society of CPAs, UCLA Dental School, and the Orange County Dental Academy. She runs her own firm in Tustin, California, providing accounting, tax, and consulting services for over 300 businesses throughout California, specializing in dental offices and small businesses. Monica, welcome to the call.
Thank you, Jeff, and thank you for everyone for being on the call tonight. I especially thank Anita York for being on this call this evening. Many of you may already know Anita. She works with a lot of dental practices, helping them with their labor law matters, and it doesn't get any easier. It's just getting more complicated. But as you've heard from Jeff, she's a partner with the firm of Scott and Whitehead, and they focus on counseling and training employers with employment law matters. She has worked with, I think it's close to 200 dentists by this time, and really is specializing in working with dentists because our labor law issues in the dental practices really can get us tied into knots and really get us into some issues, especially the associateship and the hygienists, how we pay them in dental practices. Before Anita decided to become an attorney, which has been over 17 years ago now, she was in business. She ran businesses for several years. I've known Anita for years, and she was a great manager in businesses and thought that she really understood the HR thing and management. But she has told me since she's become an attorney and doing labor law that it wasn't so. So she really does understand the realities of working in a business and what those things are as an employer. I'm happy to have Anita come back. She did this actually with us last year as well, and talk to you about what is new in wage and hour hot topics. So Anita, I turn it over to you.
Thank you, Monica. So let's go ahead and advance to the first slide. As Monica said, I've been working with businesses for many years, working with dentists for several years now. And when Monica and I talked about this program, she asked me, so what are the issues that I'm seeing today? As really the hot topics, and the answer to that is the same as it's been for some time, which is really the wage and hour issues. We have these as the primary issues, both because they're the most common mistakes, the easiest mistakes to make. They're also the most expensive mistakes to make, which means that it's the claims that the employees love to jump on when they're unhappy with you and decide that they want to come after you for something. So, per Monica's request, I've selected the topics that I think are the most troublesome to dental practices today and the things that we're seeing come up the most often. So the first two of those things really have to do with how we classify the workers. The first one is, do we classify them as independent contractors or employees? And as Monica said, this really comes into play mostly with associate dentists. The second issue is, if they're employees, how do we classify them as either exempt or non-exempt? And our primary mistakes we see here have to do with associate dentists, hygienists, and office managers. So we'll be talking about that for quite a bit of this evening. I hope you all know that on July 1st of this year, we had a new minimum wage come into play. And for many of you, you may think that doesn't really matter to you because you don't pay anybody minimum wage. But when we're paying staff on a salary basis and we're doing that to ensure that they have exempt status, in other words, you don't have to pay them overtime, then the minimum wage does come into play because it establishes the minimum salary you can pay. So we're going to talk about that to make sure that everybody has an understanding of that. We'll then talk about employee compensation rules and how do these classification factors come into play. Does it really matter? What if I'm making a mistake, what is it going to cost me potentially? And then many of you have no doubt also heard that we have a new sick leave law that's coming into effect It does not come into effect until next July 1st, but everybody's asking about it, so I want to at least take a moment to give you an idea of what it is and how it's probably going to impact dental practices. Next slide, please. So let's start out by talking about the two initial questions in classification, independent contractor versus employee, and employees, whether they're exempt or non-exempt. We'll begin with our first question. Next slide. The main question that we have to ask ourselves is, if we're classifying an associate dentist as an independent contractor, is that associate dentist really in business for themselves? Because that, by law, is the definition of an independent contractor. It's somebody who's running their own business. So, for example, if you have a fish aquarium in your office, you have somebody who's running their own business and who comes into your office once a week and takes care of the fish. They're running their own business. They're providing a service to your business. You may have a billing service that you don't do your own billing internally. You may hire somebody to do your billing. That person may do billing for 5 or 10 or 15 other dentists and runs their own business. They may have their own employees. They may have their own office, and they just come in to see you when necessary to provide the service to your business. But the bottom line is that they're in business for themselves. In most cases, associate dentists are not really in business for themselves, and when you take a step back and look objectively at what they're doing for you, you can see that they really aren't in business for themselves. So that's really where you have to think about psychologically when making a determination as to whether you can properly classify an associate dentist as an independent contractor. Next slide. So here's the things that we look at in figuring out whether or not that person is running their own business. The very first, and it's the overriding consideration, is the right to control. In other words, does the dental practice have a right to control the associate dentist? I want to make very clear that the question is not, do you control the associate dentist? It's, do you have a right to control the associate dentist? So even though the associate dentist may say to you, I only want to work on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and I'm going to take my vacations for 6 weeks a year, and I'll let you know when that is, and things like that, the truth of the matter is you could tell that associate dentist, yes or no, you may take that time off during vacation. Yes or no, you may work Tuesdays and Thursdays. I need you to work, be here for the first patient appointment, which is at 8 a.m., and I need you to be here until the end of the day, even if there's cancellations. I need you to cover for me when I'm on vacation. These are the supplies and the materials that we use. This is the way that I do billing. This is the way that I do charting. This is the way that I manage my staff, and this is what the staff works and what their hours are and how much they're paid. So, again, as you can see, the individual really isn't running their own business. They really are working for your business based on the fact that you have a right to control what they're doing. The second consideration that I see come up very frequently is, are they providing the same service that your practice provides? So, for example, if you are a general dentistry practice and they're providing general dentistry, that makes it look like they are an employee, not an independent contractor. On the other hand, if you are a general dentistry practice and you have somebody come in, say, once a month to provide dental anesthesiology services to your patients, that starts to look more like that person probably has their own business. They probably provide that service to many other dental offices. They tell you what day they're going to come in, and you can schedule patients for that day. They probably do their own billing. They probably have their own assistants. They probably bring in their own supplies. You can see how that's beginning to look more like they have their own business. Is that person associated with your practice? In other words, when your patients come in, do they think of that dentist as working for your practice, or do they have a clear understanding that they have their own separate business? Again, the dental anesthesiologist that I mentioned is probably going to be paid separately, is probably going to bill insurance separately. The patient may have to do two completely different payment, two different checks to pay that other individual because they are not associated with your practice, as opposed to the normal situation with your associate dentist. And finally, it's just taking a look at other factors that evidence business ownership and whether or not it looks like they really do have a separate business. Next slide. So we look at some of the historical traditional factors, and we say things like, but my associate dentist is incorporated, and we have a written contract that says that he or she is an independent contractor. Isn't that enough? Well, the answer is this used to be a safe harbor. Whether it was the IRS or the court system or the Franchise Tax Board or the Labor Board looking at your relationship and making a determination, it used to be the case that if you were incorporated, the associate dentist was incorporated, and there's a contract between those two corporations that says we are entering into an independent contractor relationship, then, again, whether it was the EDD or the Franchise Tax Board, whatever it may be, they would typically just look away. They didn't care because the bottom line was they were getting their taxes, which is what they really care about. So that it wasn't necessarily that the law said it was okay. It was simply this sort of informal safe harbor that the agencies and even the courts would just sort of look aside and not pay any attention. We're not seeing that anymore. What we're seeing is laws that have come into play here in California that say independent contractor misclassifications are a violation. There are penalties that were added for those misclassifications, and so we're seeing those agencies really want to come after misclassifications, and they're no longer looking the other way simply based on the fact that we have corporations who have contracted together. And Monica and I have talked a lot, and we've worked with a lot of our clients to try to figure out if you have an associate dentist coming on, can you classify them as an independent contractor? Can you set it up so they really are owning their own business and they're controlling their own practice? Hopefully they're not providing the exact same services that you're providing. You know, are there ways to set that up, or do we really need to make them into an employee? We had an audit a couple of years ago. Not Monica's client, but another client.
Yeah, I'm glad you clarified that.
Yeah, sorry, it was not one of Monica's clients. one of a client, in fact, who wasn't even a client of mine until after the audit, and they found that they'd been doing it wrong, and then they were referred to me, and we helped get them taken care of. But the audit was exactly what I've just described, a dental practice that had actually two associate dentists. Everybody was incorporated. They had a good written contract drafted by an attorney that said all the right things, and I won't go into details, but at the end of the day, the EDD still said, but it looks like an employee, therefore it is an employee, and they found the associate dentists to have been misclassified, wanted to award all sorts of penalties and fines and things. So, bottom line here is that I want you to really think in terms not just about how it's been done historically, but how the law is going to look at it and whether or not you can fit into the criteria to really have a true independent contractor relationship, or whether those associate dentists should actually be employees. If they should be employees, talk to Monica, talk to me. Let's get you on the road to getting them converted before you find out the hard way that they were misclassified.
So, yes. Anita, let's just tell them some dollars here, because they won't stop at 1 year. So, and typically this comes up if someone is unhappy with you and they go file an employment, they're going to go to the labor board, they're going to take you to every agency. So if someone leaves you and then they're unhappy, they go to all the agencies. And this is where this comes in. They go and say, yeah, I'm an employee of so-and-so, and I know they don't pay properly. And then you've got these agencies come in. And California is actually more aggressive than the IRS. You would think the other way around, but California smells money, okay? So let's tell them a little bit about the dollars, because it's not insignificant.
Boy, Monica, everything you've just said is so exactly right on. And the dollars are significant. And I'll take it one step further to say sometimes it's not even an individual who is disgruntled. Most of the time it is. You're exactly right. But sometimes it's just somebody who didn't quite understand how it all worked and thought that they were actually eligible for unemployment insurance. So they apply for unemployment, saying that they worked for you. Then EDD gets involved because your response is usually, no, they were an independent contractor. And even if that's not your response, the EDD is going to look and say, oh, they've never paid payroll taxes for this individual. What's going on? And that is an automatic trigger for an audit, automatic trigger for an audit. Once they audit, depending on who's auditing and what the approach is, the EDD will go back 3 years. The labor board will go back 3 years. If an employee is disgruntled and files a lawsuit in court, that will go back 4 years. And they will go back, and what in this one audit situation that we had, which again I became involved in at the end, in that situation, the EDD tried to impose upon the dental practice actually all of the employer contributions on all of the employer taxes, even though in that case both of the individuals, both of the associate dentists, had paid their self-employment taxes. So fortunately, we were able to negotiate some of that down. But the penalty in that particular case alone was, I believe it ended up being about $20,000. So they are significant. The EDD initially wanted over $125,000 in that matter. So we thought it was a great deal to get it down. I believe it was $10,000 per associate dentist where we had the violation. On the other hand, if it's an individual who goes to the labor board, or that was just taxes. It's an individual who goes to the labor board or who goes to court, they're going to be, and they're disgruntled, they're wanting to come after you. They're now going to be able to say, I should have been an employee. I should have gotten all of those employee benefits, whether it was paid vacation, paid sick leave, possibly paid group health insurance benefits, if you provide that to your staff. I should have gotten overtime because I was not properly classified as an exempt. We'll talk about that. All sorts of things. And then, of course, under California law, you have penalties upon penalties upon penalties for every mistake that you make. So if it comes to the light of day, it's a very expensive mistake to make.
Well, and it would go into retirement plans. I mean, it becomes all-encompassing.
Absolutely,
so
yeah.
It really becomes expensive. And, you know, Anita and I recently had a doctor that came upon this just trying to do the right thing with the new associate coming on, and we went through this myriad of all these things. And although you could work with the associate, especially if they're working in many offices, you know, three offices, four offices, to make it work, but you're relying upon the associate to do a lot of things where, you know, they won't. I mean, my experience has been, in 13 years, if you're going to leave it to the associate, it doesn't happen. So the hiring doctor that's got the practice is the one that's putting all this information together. And that just doesn't make sense. I mean, how much are you really saving by going through all this process? So, you know, we're trying to put it out here. I know people talk to each other and say, do you do this? And everyone gets this warm and fuzzy feeling, and no, we don't do those things. We treat everyone like an independent contractor. And you get this warm and fuzzy that you're okay. We're trying to let you know it's not an okay world right now.
Yes, not an okay world right now, exactly right. And I will tell you that as I've seen the audits and the evaluations, part of what they ask the associate dentist is, did you incorporate initially, independently, before you became associated with the practice, or did the practice have you get incorporated? So that's another problem, because as Monica said, you know, the associates aren't doing things on their own. You're the one who is sort of pushing them to do it, or advising them to do it, or instructing them to do it, and that's actually going to become part of what's going to be used against you in making the determination of whether or not they owned their own business. Okay, so let's move on. Hopefully I've convinced you that they probably need to be an employee unless some of those other special factors apply. So if they're an employee, we have another classification question that we have to ask sort of at the beginning of our analysis, and that is the individual, and now we're not just talking about associate dentists, we're talking about all of your staff, is the individual exempt, meaning they are exempt from overtime and other wage and hour requirements, or are they non-exempt, meaning they are not exempt and must be paid overtime, and all of those other rules apply. Obviously, we would like everybody to be exempt, but exempt, just like independent contractor status, exempt is defined by law. You must meet certain criteria to qualify as exempt, and if you do not meet those criteria, then you automatically, by default, are non-exempt. Next slide. So there are two categories of criteria that determine whether or not somebody is exempt. The first category of criteria is called the duties test. And there's several different duties and categories under this. I'm only going to be focusing this evening on the ones that apply to dental practices. So if you're thinking about other people you know or other businesses that you yourself may own, there are more categories. This is only what I see with dental practices. So the first category that qualifies as exempt if you meet the duties test is an associate dentist, and that's because we have an exemption called the professional's exemption. There's a list of professionals who automatically qualify as long as they meet the other test. One of those is licensed dentists, as long as they are working as a dentist. And I say that because I had a case one time, actually with an accountant, who she was a CPA, but she was working not for a accounting firm, but for a private company, and she was not engaged in CPA-level activities. She was really just a bookkeeper, and because of that, she did not qualify as exempt, even though she would have been listed as a professional. So it's an associate dentist who's actually working as a dentist, not as a hygienist or a billing person or an administrator or somebody else in your practice.
I'm glad you brought up hygienists, because it comes up all the time, Anita.
Comes up all the time. It does. And we're going to talk about hygienists specifically, especially when we get down to the non-exempt discussion. So business administrator, you probably can only qualify this person as exempt if they are working for your larger dental practice. And by larger, I usually say at least 3 to 4 dentists, at least 15 to 20 total staff members. And that's because to be exempt, that administrator or office manager or whatever name you give to them must spend at least half of their time actually managing. That means they're not sitting at the front desk, they're not checking patients in and out, they're not doing your insurance billing and collections and your callbacks. They're sitting probably in a separate office managing your practice, whether it's managing your staff, managing your contracts, handling large, significant problems, not day-to-day individual patient issues. So again, that usually is only going to apply to the larger practices with at least 15 or so employees. Your relative will be automatically considered to be exempt if they're your spouse, your parent, or your child. It does not apply to extended family members. Now, here in California, we have laws about registered domestic partners. Therefore, in my opinion, although the wage order that I'm referring to does not specifically say registered domestic partner, I would argue that because they are treated like the same as spouses, that they would also qualify. There are some other categories. Again, we're not going to talk about those, but to emphasize, for the most part, when we're talking about the duties test and who qualifies, your hygienists will not qualify. Most of your office managers will not qualify. Certainly your other front office, back office, chairside assistants, folks like that don't qualify. For the most part, we are only going to be talking about associate dentists who are licensed working as a dentist, and they fit the second exempt classification requirement, next slide please, which is that they meet the salary basis test. What the salary basis test says is that in order to be exempt, if you meet the duties test, then you must also be paid a minimum of the applicable minimum wage times 2, so doubled, times 40 hours per week, even if you're only working 5 hours per week. So let's go through that. First of all, let me start by saying this is where I was talking about the new California minimum wage becomes important for you, even if you don't pay minimum wage. That used to be $8 an hour. It's now $9 per hour as of January 1st. And in a year and a half from now, on January 1st, 2016, it goes to $10 per hour. Of course, in some places, it's more than that. Certain cities, San Francisco, San Jose, so if your practice is in those locations, you have minimum wages that are even higher. So when we're looking at the salary basis test and how the minimum wage comes into play, what it says to us is that prior to July 1st, you had to pay a minimum of $640 per week or $2,774 per month. More importantly for our purposes today is that now if you have a dentist who you want to qualify as exempt, you must pay that dentist no less than $720 per week or $3,120 per month. It doesn't matter if he or she only works one day a week for you. It doesn't matter if you want to pay them on a per diem basis. You must pay them not less than $720 per week or $3,120 per month. January 1st, 2016, those rates are going to go up a bit.
And that's because there's some wage order that says for a professional there's a certain amount per hour that they make?
All of the wage orders say that, yes. So for anybody to qualify as exempt, they must meet the duties test. That's what we talked about. There are many more duties, but those are the ones that apply to dental practices. But across the board, they must always meet the salary basis test, which is what this is. So again, if you have a business administrator who meets the duties tests and earns at least this much, they can be exempt. But for the most part, we're talking about associate dentists. Okay, so let's go to the next slide just to talk about kind of how this plays out in your real world. What this means, again, is that the minimum time frame that you can be looking at is a week. It's not a day. That means that daily per diem fails. And if you pay somebody on a daily per diem basis, that results in a guaranteed salary that is less than $720 per week or $3,120 per month, they are no longer exempt. We'll talk about what that means in a minute, but it's very significant. It also means that you cannot pay your dentist solely on a production basis. Now, in a sense, this is semantics, because if you have a dentist who's working for you even a couple of days a week, they're going to be earning more than $720 a week, or frankly, they're not going to be working for you for very long. And so the reason I say it's a matter of semantics is because we write the contract so that we have this minimum base guaranteed in there, and then production, which is virtually always going to be more than $720 as long as they're working more than one day a week, we just do a sort of math equation to make that work. So I just want to be clear that it's not that you cannot pay on a production basis. We just have to write the contract properly, but they still have to have that guaranteed minimum base salary of $720 per week or $3,120 per month. So because of this, that's why we recommend that you pay the minimum weekly salary or monthly. You may have a dentist who works one day, one week, 2 days the next week, one day the next week, 2 days the next week. So you're better off looking at that monthly rate rather than the weekly rate, which is all perfectly fine. So why do we care? Why, this is all very complicated. Why do we have to go through all of this? What's the big deal? Next slide. The reason that we go through this is because if somebody does not qualify as exempt, they don't meet both of those two tests, the duties test and the salary basis test, then they are automatically non-exempt. And for everybody who's non-exempt, it means five things. They must be paid overtime. So even if you pay a salary, you still owe overtime. They must be provided a non-working meal period. They must be provided non-working rest breaks. They must maintain accurate time records. And their pay stubs must actually show certain information. So let's go through those one by one to make sure that I'm clear on what matters. Next slide. First, they must be paid overtime. Overtime here in California is more than 8 hours a day or 40 hours per week. So going up to our first point here, you're permitted to pay a salary. If you want to pay somebody $1,000 a week or $2,000 a week salary, whatever, you're welcome to do so. But if they don't qualify as exempt, in other words, the duties test isn't met in my scenario, you still have to pay overtime. So $1,000 a week divided by 40 hours comes to $25 per hour. If you had that employee and you were not paying overtime, let's say they're working 1 hour per day of overtime, 4 to 5 days per week, you're looking at going back 3 to 4 years if they file a claim with either the labor board or with the courts, and you're going to owe all of that back overtime. Same problem with daily per diem. You can pay a daily per diem if you want, but that does not change the fact that you're going to owe overtime for everything over 8 hours a day or 40 hours per week. For those reasons, I recommend that non-exempt employees be paid on an hourly basis. Now, there is one potential exception, by the way, for the 8 hour per day overtime rule, and that's called an alternative work week schedule. We'll talk about that towards the end of our program this evening. So, go ahead.
Anita, if they're in staff meetings, if they're in, are there, but they're not really working, and how does that relate towards working hours?
That's a great question. So what the rule says is employees must be paid for all time worked. The time worked is any time that you're basically controlling what they're doing. They can't leave and go do something else. So if you have a staff meeting and you're doing that during lunchtime and you're bringing in food and everybody's sitting around eating, that is controlled time. That means that is time worked. It all counts towards whether or not they've worked 8 hours in a day or more than 8 hours in a day. if you have, you know, perhaps a rep come in, a vendor rep come in, and she brings lunch, and she kind of talks to people about the new, you know, update in the EagleSoft software program or whatever it may be. Again, they're now under your control. Even though they're eating and they're sitting and they're relaxing, work is being performed. They're being required to be under your control. That means that all counts towards time worked, and it probably is going to get you to more than 8 hours in a day and into more than more overtime.
If they could get up and leave this lunch thing where the vendor comes in, is that controlled time?
It is if business is being discussed. So they may, you know, they may be able to leave, but they're going to miss out on some job-relevant information. Now, on the other hand, if the vendor's bringing lunch in and no business is being discussed, they're just doing it for PR to make everybody happy, and everybody can leave, nobody needs to be there, they're not going to miss out on any, you know, business discussion, then no, nothing needs to be paid for. And in fact, what you might even want to do is have the employees spend a half hour eating, no business talk, and they can leave if they want. You know, but maybe the second half hour of lunch, we're going to be discussing the new software or whatever it may be, and that's when they're required to be there. At least that way you're not paying for that entire lunch hour. They can go do what they want for a half hour, and then you're only paying for a half hour. It's one of the ways to try and work through that. Okay, good. Next slide is that the employee must be provided non-working meal periods. So this is the second of our five requirements for all non-exempt employees, and this is part of what Monica's just been raising. So you must provide a non-working meal period if the employee is going to work 5 or more hours, except that if they're going to work 6 or less hours, you and the employee together can choose to waive that employee's meal period if they have a specific written agreement signed. There's some kind of magic language to that waiver, so if you need that, get in touch with Monica or get in touch with me, and we'll help you take care of that. It must be for at least 30 consecutive minutes, not interrupted, cannot interfere or discourage in any way. So in other words, if the employee goes out, you can't be calling them on their cell phone saying, hey, next patient, are they coming, are they not coming? You cannot interrupt, cannot interfere. Employee clocks out and clocks back in because this is an unpaid meal period, but time records must be accurate, so that means you cannot have an automatic clock out for 12 to 1 or 12:30 to 1:30. They must actually clock out when they stop working. They actually clock back in when they start working again. It's supposed to be provided before the end of the fifth hour of work. This is a problem in some practices. There are some ways that you can try and get around it, but the rule is it must begin before the end of the fifth hour of work, and they have to be permitted to leave the premises. So again, that's what Monica was talking about. If you've got people coming in, you're doing training during lunch period, then are they really permitted to leave the premises and go do whatever they want to do? There are some other waivers besides this, the very first bullet point that I was talking about. I guess this is the second bullet point. They probably are not applicable to most dental practices, but if you've heard of those other waivers, that's why I'm not mentioning them this evening. Next slide, our third requirement is that employees must be provided non-working 10-minute rest breaks. I'm using the term provided both with respect to meal periods and rest breaks for the following reason. Your obligation as an employer is to provide employees the time, the opportunity, the realistic schedule that enables them to take those meal periods and to take the rest breaks. Prior to about a year and a half ago, the law said if they skip their lunch, even if you provide the ability, you could be sued because they skipped their lunch. So we got a little bit of a break from the California Supreme Court because the court said, no, that's not the rule. The rule is as long as you have a policy for those meal periods and you provide the ability to take those meal periods, you cannot be sued if the employee violates your policy. A little bit different for rest breaks. Rest breaks, you must provide a 10-minute break in the morning, a 10-minute break in the afternoon, this is assuming somebody who's working all day. It must be at least 10 consecutive minutes. It does not work to say my employees go take a minute or two or three or five whenever they want, and they do that multiple times a day. It's not cumulative. It's 10 minutes in a row. You must provide the realistic ability for them to do that. So it's not sufficient to say I've never stopped them. They must actually be able to do it. So, for example, one of the things that we see come up quite often is hygienists. You have the patient scheduled in hour blocks, right, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. And some hygienists are very quick, and they have 15-minute breaks most of the time between patients. But other hygienists are not. Other hygienists take the better part of that hour, they run their patients back to back, and they really don't have the opportunity for that 10-minute break. That's a violation, and it's a costly violation if that hygienist becomes disgruntled and wants to come after you. So what I tell dentists is this: have a written policy in your employee handbook that says something like, everybody's entitled to their 10-minute break, just have somebody cover for you during your break. Hygienists can ask any assistant to break down the treatment room, to bring in the next patient, get the next patient set up while the hygienist takes the break. Hopefully that takes about 10 minutes and gives the hygienist the opportunity for the break. In other situations, hopefully you have the ability for somebody to cover your front office individuals, and hopefully you can do without a chairside assistant when they want to take a 10-minute break, or you have somebody can back them up. But unlike meal periods, there are no waivers. There's no such thing as a waiver for a rest break. Employees must be realistically able to take 10 consecutive minutes for breaks. These are paid breaks, so the employees do not clock out for them. Because they're paid breaks, you can require that they remain on your premise. That's also different than the meal periods. Again, like the meal periods, they're uninterrupted, or technically speaking, they're supposed to be able to start their 10-minute break over because it didn't really count. Okay, the fourth requirement for non-exempt employees is that accurate time records are required. And the reason I've put specifically on the slide the employer must maintain the accurate time records is because by law it is the employer's responsibility. Now, of course, employers delegate that responsibility to the employee, but the law doesn't care. The law says it never is the employee's responsibility. Legally speaking, it's the employer's. So you want to be sure that your time records are accurate, that the employees are clocking in when they begin work, they're clocking out when they stop for meal periods, they're clocking back in when they resume work, they're clocking out when they stop work at the end of their work day. We're going to talk a little bit about on-call at the end of the program, but if you have employees who do on-call for you, whether it's an associate dentist who's not exempt, remember these rules apply to non-exempt employees, or whether it's perhaps a hygienist or a chairside assistant who carries the pager and handles the on-calls unless you're needed, all on-call time is considered time work, so employees must clock in for that. If a non-exempt employee is required to return to the office due to an on-call emergency, then the commute time is also considered time work. That's very much unlike during the work week, right? We don't pay for commute time normally. This is a special rule that applies to on-calls. So again, as we mentioned before, employees must be paid for all time worked. Ultimately, it is the employer's responsibility. Our last go ahead, Mike.
Office manager. Okay.
Yes.
Every dental office will tell you they've got an office manager. Okay. Now, you mentioned that really supervising people, hiring and firing, and that is probably a bigger dental office than a one-location office, or it's a big office where there's a lot of hygiene and a lot of chairside assistants, and it's very busy. But every office will say they've got an office manager. What if the doctor gives the office manager a cell phone, and, you know, in case somebody is going to call in sick or late or, you know, to keep track of trying to get a hold of people in case there's an emergency? How does that play into this?
On-call has two different sides of the coin. One is what's called uncontrolled standby, and one is called controlled standby. Controlled standby means that my free time is so restricted by the on-call requirements that I basically cannot do whatever it is that I want to do. So in other words, I have to be back at the office within 10 minutes if I get a call. I cannot leave more than, you know, drive more than 15, 20 minutes away from the office or my home because I may get a call. I may have to be somewhere on a moment's notice. I may need to be awake on a moment's notice. That's called controlled standby. It's very expensive because it means that now that employee must be paid for all of the time that they're waiting to work. Fortunately, I've never seen a dental practice that has that kind of on-call. That usually applies to other kinds of businesses. That leaves us with the other side of the coin, which is what's called uncontrolled standby. So what you want to do with uncontrolled standby is make sure that it's clear that you are not controlling them to the extent that they cannot engage in whatever personal activities they choose. That means that perhaps you say they need to be able to return a phone call on that cell phone that you gave them within 20 or 30 minutes. That's certainly fine. It means that you might be able to say they must be able to get into the office within an hour. That's fine. And what I'm saying, I'm giving these times is because we have case law that says these periods of time and these distances are appropriate to say it's still uncontrolled. So, you know, if I live in Mission Viejo and I'm visiting my friend in Huntington Beach, I can get back to work in Mission Viejo within an hour. I'm able to do what I want to do. So what that means is then from the time that you answer the phone, take the call, and actually engage in work, whether it's talking to them on the phone, whether it's then calling somebody else, perhaps the dentist themselves, whether it's going into the office, that's all time that is now controlled work time, and it's all compensable.
Okay.
Fifth criteria requirement for non-exempt employees is that the wage statement, which is really the pay stub, has to include certain data, and that data for our purposes that we care about right now is that it must include the total hours worked and the applicable rate of pay per category. So when you pay somebody a salary, you don't show the total hours worked, and you certainly don't show the applicable rate of pay per category. On the other hand, non-exempt employees, you must show total hours worked. And so say I make my $25 per hour and I worked 38 hours this week of straight time, so that's going to be my 38 hours times my $25 is $950. But let's say I also had 5 hours of overtime. So that 5 hours of overtime is listed separately because it's a different category. It's going to show my 5 hours. My applicable rate of pay is $37.50 because it's time and a half. I can't do the math in my head, but whatever that comes to, that's a different line item. So that's one of the places we see a violation when somebody is misclassified who should be a non-exempt employee. Okay, so again, taking you through some complicated things. It seems like a lot of steps. Why do we care? We care because the potential penalties are expensive. Let's go through them. If you're not paying the person overtime, you must pay all unpaid overtime plus interest. If they're not getting their full 30-minute uninterrupted, non-working, I can go do what I want to do meal period, the penalty, if you're called on the carpet for it, is 1 hour per day. Now, that's at the straight time rate. It's not the overtime rate. But it's not a half hour, even though a half hour is what's required for you to give them. It's 1 hour of pay. If they're not able to realistically take rest breaks, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, it's another entire hour of pay. As Monica raised the issue earlier, those go back 3 years if the person files with the labor board, 4 years if they file in court. Accurate time records, the bad news here is for if you have somebody who's being paid on a per diem, daily per diem, production basis, or a salary basis, you don't usually have them keep time records. If it turns out that you were paying them that way and therefore they were misclassified, then the employee gets to estimate whatever time they worked, estimate for the last 3 or 4 years, and that estimate is presumed to be correct unless you can prove they didn't. You cannot prove it by saying, I always work late and they were never here. That doesn't prove it. Proof means we have video cameras that show the time in each day and the time out each day, and I kept them for the last 3 years, and I can prove it. Nobody does that. Video recordings usually go back 30 days. I have a computer system that the minute they get in, they have to log in and they have to log out. That would be considered proof, but most people don't do that for employees who are not keeping time records. So not keeping accurate time records is a big problem for you if the employee decides to come after you. Last but not least, pay stubs. Pay stub, the violation is basically $4,000 is your max in penalties. And the reason I kind of put it that way is because that's the good news. That's the least of your problems if you have these violations and somebody comes after you. In addition, if an employee decides to sue you, they get all their attorney's fees and all of their litigation costs if they win. Now, before we go on, let me say this. If you're listening to me this evening and you're thinking, okay, I get it, but my office manager has been with me for 25 years. There's no way I'm going to tell her now, guess what, Sue, you have to start keeping a timesheet. I'm just not going to do it because I'm not going to go through, and I'm paying you hourly. And if you work 38 hours, that's all you're getting paid for. And if you work 42, I'll pay you for that. I'm just not going to do it. Let me put it this way, if I can. Let's at least reduce your potential for penalties if you're not going to make the change. How can we do that? One simple step. Step number four, at least have that person keep accurate time records, and here's why. If they're keeping accurate time records, then number four is taken care of, and you don't have the risk of that person becoming disgruntled and estimating too high. Number two, if you end up having to pay that person overtime in item number one, then at least it's going to be the accurate time and not the exaggerated version, which I assure is what you get when people estimate. In our requirement number two, hopefully because they're keeping accurate time records, you're going to be able to demonstrate that they got their meal periods. And number three, hopefully if they're keeping accurate time records and you're showing that you're doing the other things correct, you'll be able to convince a court or a labor commissioner that they were getting rest breaks. So if you at least have them keep accurate time records, you're minimizing your damages, you're minimizing the potential violations just by making that one change. So if I haven't convinced you to convert them entirely to non-exempt, at least do that for me, for you. Okay, next slide. I talked earlier about potential way to overcome the 8 hours per day of overtime. Many dental practices work four tens, right? You work Monday through Thursday 10 hours, or you work 9 hours, or maybe you work 9 hours plus half a day on Friday. And under the rules I just told you, you owe overtime for that last hour, that ninth hour. There is a potential way around it. That's called alternative work week schedule. Many of you have heard of this. Many of you think about flexible work schedules. Here's the deal. You can't just implement one. You have to cross the T's and dot the I's in following all of the rules that are required to implement it. Here's the rules. You have to hold a meeting that says we're going to do an alternative work week schedule election. Explain what it means, and you have to give a written notice that contains certain information. You must wait at least 2 weeks, hold a secret ballot election for everybody who's going to be it's going to apply to, and that election has to approve the alternative work week schedule by at least two-thirds. It's not just a 50% vote, it's two-thirds. The critical step that most people skip, even if they've gotten those first two right, is you must send a letter up to the Department of Labor Statistics Research. It's a sort of a related entity to the labor board. Has to have certain information in it. You must do that within 30 days. If you do not, then your entire alternative work week schedule is invalid and you owe overtime for everything over 8 hours in a day. The fourth step, which is not a requirement, but I do recommend it, is a written acknowledgement that the employee signs saying, yes, I know we're on an alternative work week schedule and I know and I understand how it works. There's many other little pieces to that. I'm not going to go into all of that tonight. We're almost at the end of our time. But these are very critical steps. If you need help with it, obviously I can help you with that.
Okay. What if they've been doing this for years, Anita? Many have. Because a long time ago, 10, 12, 15 years ago, someone said you didn't need to get any official approval. You could just do it. So people have been doing this for a long time.
Yeah.
Do you suggest they immediately just go and have this election and at least get it going from now, or does that bring a red flag to everyone, like, why are we doing it now?
And you know that question applies to almost everything I've mentioned tonight. So let's say you decide that you have an associate dentist who should be an employee. Let's say you have a hygienist who you've been paying on a daily per diem and you now realize you should be paying hourly. Whatever change you want to make, that's always the question we have to ask, is are we waving a red flag that says, I've been doing it wrong and you could sue me. Now I'm going to make the change. That's always the fear. You know, as I tell people all the time, it's all in how you sell it. And we try and figure out a way in your particular situation to sell it. So, for example, in this context, alternative work week schedule, we draft the documents to say, you know, it's been so many years since we did this. I've been told that we should update paperwork. So we're redoing the election just to make sure that we have the paperwork on file. So here it is. We're doing the meeting. Here's the notice. We're going to do the ballot, the election with those secret ballots. By the way, employees, if you don't approve it, no problem, no retaliation whatsoever, but then we're just going to convert to a traditional 5-day-a-week, 8-hour-per-day schedule because I can't afford the overtime and we need to keep the production schedule up. If you tell them that that's the alternative, you'll probably get your election approved. because nobody wants to go back to a traditional schedule.
Yeah.
In terms of if you're converting employees from exempt to non-exempt or things like that, we just need to kind of talk through your specific situation and how to do it. One of the things I talk about sometimes is, you know, maybe if you roll out a new employee handbook, roll out new paperwork, maybe you're changing your employee benefits, maybe you're changing some other things, you sort of incorporate it in with, you know, I've been talking to these consultants and reading the stuff from CDA and seeing things online, and it sounds like we should do things this way, or, you know, it seems more fair to do it this way, whatever. There's ways we can try and roll it in that hopefully we don't, you know, attract too much attention. Okay, next slide. There are many, many, many other critical wage and hour issues, and I knew that I was going to get to the hour being almost up and not have much time to go through these, but let me just touch on them, and by touch I mean I'm just going to sort of plant the seed that these are issues maybe that you want to be thinking about. Regular rate rules, what the regular rate rules say is that overtime is due on all compensation. So if you pay employees, say, an hourly rate because you're doing it correctly, but you also have incentive pay, and by the way, I'm a huge fan of incentive pay. I think we human beings are incentivized by incentive pay, production bonuses, things like that. But the law says if you pay a bonus or you pay production pay to a non-exempt employee, then you still owe overtime based on that bonus or production pay. I'm not going to get into how that works tonight, but if it's your issue, make a note, something we should talk about. If you have employees who are on a percentage-based pay plan, that has to be by written agreement. This is a new law that came into play a couple of years ago. Written agreement has to say how it's calculated. You, the employer, must sign it, and the employee must sign it. Working interviews. I hear dental practices telling me all the time, I have someone coming in for a working interview, and then it turns out a month later they're still on a working interview. That is not a working interview. That is an employee. This is kind of related to item number 4 on this list. New hires are not temps while you try them out. So what I say is this. If you have somebody who you want to do a working interview with, do not do more than one day. As a lawyer, my legal advice, I don't even like one day because they're really still an employee. But, again, I know you live in the real world. Maybe you're going to say, too bad, I always do them. It's important for me to see if a hygienist can clean a tooth. Do it for one day. Don't do it for more than that day. Do it by even a brief written agreement that says you're going to do a working interview for me on Tuesday, September 30th from 9 to 5. You'll have a half-hour lunch. I'm going to pay you $10 an hour for the day. We agree that's how it's going to work. Write a check that same day. Even if you're going to hire the person, pay them for that one day. And make call that your working interview. Don't do it for longer than that. Temps. Temps are not temps while you try them out. They're temps if they're temps. A temp means you are temporarily working here. Perhaps you're covering a leave of absence. Perhaps you're helping me get all of my charts computerized. Perhaps you're helping us catch up on billing because we're behind and I need some help. Whatever it may be, it is not intended for you to work there on an ongoing basis. You are there for a finite period of time. Anybody else is just a new hire. Even though you're trying them out, they are just a new hire. On-call and reporting time pay, I already talked about that a little bit in terms of the on-call. Reporting time pay, I'll just throw in one more piece of what I've already talked about, which is that if an employee has to, and again, we're talking about non-exempts, because remember, your exempts are paid a salary, so it doesn't matter. But for your non-exempts, if they have to come back to your office, if they have to report back to work, they must be paid a minimum of 2 hours. Now, again, we're going to include their commute time when they're coming back because of an on-call, but reporting time pay rules say they have to earn at least two hours. Reimbursable expenses. If you require employees to purchase a very specific uniform, which is probably not something that they're going to be wearing at their next job, so let's say your uniform happens to be purple with pink swirls. That's probably not going to be the same uniform they can wear doing the job somewhere else. That means it must be paid for by the practice. On the other hand, if your uniform is simply wear scrubs, I don't care what color, just wear scrubs, then you do not need to reimburse it because that probably is a uniform that that individual can wear at the next job. Monica talked about giving an employee a dental practice cell phone, in other words, your business cell phone that they may be going to use for on-call. If you don't do that and they have on-call and they're using their own cell phone, you probably have to reimburse the part of that expense. Similarly, if you have a policy that says if you're going to be late, you must text message or call the office manager's cell phone in the morning, you probably need to be reimbursing part of the office manager's cell phone. Continuing education and meetings, we talked about lunch meetings, you have to pay for them. The same rules apply in many circumstances if you're sending an employee to CDA or if you're having employees go to some other kind of continuing education. Again, the rules are a little bit strict. We're not going to go into those in too much detail, but I want to plant the seed for you to understand that you should be asking a question before assuming that you can have employees go and not pay them. Vacation, sick leave, and PTO, there are very specific rules that apply to vacation. Those rules are different than the rules for sick leave. The primary one I want you to hear from me tonight is that you cannot say after you've been here 1 year, you get 1 week of vacation. The law says it must accrue as they work. Now, you can have a waiting period before they can use it, but not a waiting period before it's accrued if you then give it to them lump sum. The point there is you cannot have a lump sum at the end. Much more detailed than what I've just said, but again, I want to plant the seed that if your policy says after 1 year you get 1 week and after 2 years you get 2 weeks, your rule is not in compliance with California law. July 1st, 2015, we have new sick leave rules. Most dental practices offer some amount of paid time off, whether it's vacation or sick leave or PTO, to their full-time staff that is going to fulfill the new paid sick leave rules. The two problems that I see most dental practices are going to have with the new rules are the following. Number one, you must provide some amount of paid time off, whether it's PTO or sick leave, even for part-time employees, so that's going to be a change for most of you, and you must provide it for everybody, including your dentists and your hygienists. So in my experience, most practices have rules that say front office, chairside assistants, here's what you get in benefits, associate dentists and hygienists, you do not get employee benefits. Of course, everybody knows they're highly paid. They don't necessarily expect benefits. That's going to change. They're going to be getting some paid time off for sick leave. And again, most people don't worry too much about benefits for part-time employees, but the new rules are going to require that you do provide paid time off for part-time employees also. Okay, let's go to the next slide very quickly. I've talked about a lot of things tonight. If you have a good employee handbook, many of those things should be covered by a good employee handbook. It's going to cover the legally mandated notices. Hopefully, it's going to communicate your expectations of the employees and answer their questions. It will help you in making decisions, in enforcing your own policies. And if you're ever challenged with a claim of some kind, hopefully, it's going to help you show that you comply with the law. For example, you will have a good meal period and rest break policy in your employee handbook that you can say, see, look, here's the policies that we follow. And, of course, it will confirm at-will employment, which we didn't talk about tonight, but it's another key issue. Okay, next slide. I do want to mention that Monica and I have talked about doing a seminar in January, and we're going to do that. It'll be on January 23rd here at my office in Newport Beach, beginning at 9 a.m. and going till noon. We will be talking about some of these things, and in particular, we're going to be talking about those critical issues that I just spent about 1 minute each on. We're going to be talking at the time about all the new laws that will come into effect for 2015. We will definitely be going into more detail about the new sick leave law, what it means to you, how it plays out, what you can and what you cannot do. And we'll probably spend some time at that point talking about leaves of absence because we have not focused on that in our prior seminars. And I'm seeing my dental clients get into trouble, particularly with pregnancy disability, medical leaves that seem to go on forever. What can you do, what you can you not do, and I want to make sure that we spend some time talking about that. So keep watch for the email notification on that. You might want to go ahead and at least pencil that into your calendar, and hopefully we'll see you here on January 23rd. Also want to mention if there's anything I've said this evening that sort of raises a question for you, or if you have other questions, I'm always happy to do a free initial 15-minute telephone consultation. Just email me, call me, whatever. Let me know that you were on the Rebella Accountancy webinar or that you were referred by Monica, and I'll be happy to spend that time at least hopefully getting you started on whatever your issue is. That's it for me this evening. Thank you very much. Monica, is there anything I didn't cover that we should mention?
Oh, I think there's a lot of things we didn't cover, but I can't do it in an hour. No, I think it was speed learning, and my head is spinning, Anita. So I think everyone else is probably as well. Be there in January, January the 23rd. It's on a Friday. It's from 9 to noon. I know some doctors work in the morning, but maybe this far in advance, you can change that day to be there. We don't typically recommend that other people in the office come. Isn't that right, Anita?
I'm so glad you said that. Yes, this is a dentists-only program. Sometimes you might want to bring, if you have a spouse who helps you administer things in your office, that's certainly always fine. But I really do not recommend that you bring any staff members because chances are I'm going to be telling you something that you're doing wrong, and you don't want me to be telling your staff member what you're doing wrong.
Yeah, because it would spread like wildfire in the office.
So it does.
We really want this to be doctors and spouses. We're trying to make sure that you're aware of these things. I know Anita goes down this road, but I get a lot of calls, and you would be surprised at the people that are unhappy or bring these things up. You know, a lot of times when I talk about this with the doctors, it's, she's been with me for so many years, I can't believe this. Well, yeah, they aren't going to tell you that they're going to take you to the labor board. You just don't know what's going to happen. So we want to make sure at least you're aware of some of these ideas, not ideas, but these labor laws, and that you're putting them into practice in the office. If you have an office manager and you're delegating it to them and you're delegating to the payroll company, that's great, but it doesn't take the responsibility off of you. It's out of your pocket if it's done wrong. This is what we're trying to make you aware of. So, Anita, thank you so much. Jeff, does she have any questions from the audience?
She does not. We've opened up the lines. I don't see any on the webinar, on the webcast. But, Anita, just to give folks listening on the replay a chance to get a hold of you if they want a free 15-minute telephone consultation, what's your phone number and email address to get a hold of you?
Terrific. Thanks, Jeff. Email address is Anita, A-N-I-T-A, at employerlaw, that's all one word, .com, employerlaw.com. I do watch my emails, and I have to admit I do tend to respond to those faster than the phone calls if I'm not here when the phone call comes in. Our phone number here at Scott and Whitehead is 222-0166. That's area code 949. And I will say I have clients all over the state of California, so don't let the location slow you down if you're interested in talking about anything related to California law.
Great. Super. Anita, thank you very much for being on the call. Monica, thank you. And again, we want to thank everybody for listening, whether you're on the call live today or listening on the replay. The topic was Wage and Hour Hot Topics for Today's Dental Practice, again, hosted by Monica Rebella, CPA, President of Rebella Accountancy, with our presenter tonight, Anita York, partner at Scott & Whitehead. Again, ladies, thank you very much for being on the call, and we'll talk to you soon.
Thanks,
you.
Bye-bye.
Have a nice evening. Bye-bye.